Their parliaments, their ambassadors, their guests and followers of the Congress welcome you all. Unfortunately, our program moderator, Ambassador Hulusi Kılıç, could not be able to attend to this session due to an urgent program, but he expressed his apologies and greetings due to this situation. And in addition, Mr. Cemalettin Tuna is going to attend as soon as possible. We're waiting for the Kazakhstan ambassador. Inshallah, Mr. Elman Nasirov, as a parliamentary in Azerbaijan, he's on the way to attend Cuba genocide meeting. But if he can find enough time, he will be able to attend our meeting from his mobile. In addition, Mr. Abdullah Çalışkan, he is also the chairman in Turkish parliamentary institution. Unfortunately, he's continuing to be treated in the hospital due to COVID reason. We hope Allah will give shifa to him. We are praying for him. Now we have our ambassadors from Kyrgyzstan, Afghanistan and Pakistan here. Inshallah, as I mentioned, our Kazakhstan ambassador and Mr. Cemalettin Tuna is going to attend also. Let me give a small introductory part. As TESPAM, you may know, with a vision of regional collaborated energy unity with a name of Turkish Energy Union, but which may also include our brother countries such as Afghanistan and Pakistan and Tajikistan, and maybe in the future Qatar and other similarly situated countries, we are continuing our attempts. In this regard of making many different studies, initially to raise awareness among the Turkish states, we are organizing this Congress, and this Congress is one of the most important steps. And we also started to work on lots of databases regarding with global dynamics and with Basharsoft. And we have completed some training programs and prepared the global 2100 projections for the global dynamics and for the Turkic countries. Regarding with oil and export potentials. And we hold lots of webinars like smaller activities and published journals, articles, papers on this theme. And we also found TEBAM, which is oriented to focus on the Turkic world. And lastly, as you know, we're organizing this Congress. And I think these two commercial integration sessions in the Congress are very important. Again, I have to mention that all these activities aims to raise the awareness of Turkish countries on this vision. And hopefully now, as the roof of international organization among the Turkic countries, Turkish Council is trying to coordinate energy ministers of the member states and founding an inner study group focusing on this area. And this is a good step, but of course it's not enough. If the integration process will only stay on bureaucratic and academic levels, this will not be able to be sustainable, as I think. And a small conflict between the members or a political change in one of the Turkey countries' administrations may affect all the balances and may give a floor for a chance to end all these studies. And such an act will cause this huge vision to be perceived and stigmatized as a big failure. In this case, the connections should be integrated and connected in a way that is economically strengthened and difficult to give up, with a principle of mutual win-win. And that's why today, commercial integration and investment opportunities sessions are very important. I don't want to waste time by this introductory part, and let me give the floor to our speakers. Initially, we are going to start with the Ambassador of Kazakhstan, Mr. Amir Muhammad Ramin. Please, the floor is yours. I'm opening your microphone.
Thank you very much, my brother. for this very, very important event. I want to also thank TechFarm, the Ahmad Yesevi University, and other organizers. You have been here involved in this event. I also want to thank Ambassador of Pakistan, Ambassador of Kyrgyzstan, and other ambassadors who will be joining us as we continue our discussions. This is a very, very important topic because not only our region, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Central Asia, energy discussions are going to be become increasingly more important, but also there are many, many opportunities that our countries would support in terms of expertise, but also investment from our Turkish brothers can really achieve new heights and new areas. But also this particular composition of bringing Pakistan, Afghanistan, or Central Asian neighbors, friends, and brothers is also very important because culturally we have many commonalities. And I've said this time and again that starting from Turkey to Caucasus to Central Asia, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iran, and the rest of the region, we have the same culture, we have the same faith, we have many, many other commonalities, but the fundamental question is how to transform these commonalities into real cooperation. And when you look at the statistics, unfortunately, we still have to do quite a lot, especially in terms of connecting Central Asia to South Asia, in terms of trade, including and especially energy, because this is a sector that we are now working to develop. Also, I will speak a little bit about the opportunities inside Afghanistan in terms of the energy market, energy resources, but also the regional aspect of it. So we have Central Asia that is energy rich. We have our brothers in Pakistan and also in Central Asia, South Asia in general, that increasingly are in demand of energy. So how we can really find ways to have also energy cooperation expanded between our countries. So inside Afghanistan, we have obviously Shebaghan gas. This gas field was earlier contracted to a Chinese company, but for a number of reasons, the development has been a little bit slow, although there has been some progress lately. But also our focus is to, as we go and continue to use energy resources such as gas, our focus is to see how we can use energy resources from other areas, including and especially renewable, because this is an area that is developing rapidly and can be very, very sustainable environmentally, but also economically. So along with the hydropower, which we have been focusing over the past few years quite a lot, starting from Salma Dam in Herat, recently Kamal Khan Dam in Nimroz province, but also expanding to other provinces. You know, this is an area that we would like to expand, and we are very much open to have a partnership with private investors as well as governments to see how we can, in terms of the usage of these resources, work together. Just to give an example, over the Kunar Dam, we have always said this, that there is a lot of potential for us and Afghanistan to for us in Afghanistan and for our brothers in Pakistan to see how or if we can use the water for generating electricity to use together, both of us. The details can be discussed, and we are also open to attract investment from Turkey in this sector. And obviously, this is one sector. The other sector within the renewable energy is solar as well as wind. And there's massive opportunities. We only use very little, 5% of our capacity in terms of renewable energy in solar as well as wind. So in terms of Afghanistan is as in certain ways it's unfortunate because this winter was we had very little rain and snow, but we have a lot of sun, so this sun can be used to generate electricity. Wind, certain provinces, northwest in Herat province as well as Kandahar, also northern provinces, are very good places for generating wind energy. So these are very, very important sectors, and we are very keen to work with private companies as well as with governments to invest in these very, very important sectors. Regionally, there are a number of very, very important projects underway. And I'll also talk about the some of the risk factors, and the biggest, which is unfortunately security. And we hope to be able to overcome as we continue to make progress in the peace process, especially the upcoming Istanbul meeting. So the energy, we all know that, you know, Central Asia is especially Turkmenistan as well as, you know, other Central Asian neighbors, our friends and brothers, they have energy surplus. Turkmenistan, we have a number of very, very important projects, including TAP and TAPI. TAP is the electricity project that is aimed to transmit electricity from Turkmenistan to Pakistan via Afghanistan. This is a project that is underway and a very, very important investor. In fact, the key and the only one with a lot of commitment is Çalık Holdings. I had a very good meeting with Ahmet Çalık, who reiterated his strong commitment that once this project is successful, this could be expanded to other areas as well. Çalık Holdings could expand, you know, energy investment in other sectors as well as investment in other areas. And also, this is an investment that is it's $1.6 billion investment, which is unique because under the current circumstances, especially because of the security in the region of Afghanistan, not many companies take the risk. But the fact that Çalık Holding is taking the risk is showing our Turkish friend and brother's commitment to regional prosperity. This is a very high percentage of this is completed, and we hope to be able to complete this soon. And also, we have TAPI, which is aimed to transfer gas from Turkmenistan via Afghanistan to Pakistan and to India. And also, many other opportunities in terms of investment in the energy sector. We are very here at the embassy. Open and active to engage with private sector, those who want to invest in the energy sector, as well as closely work with our here friends in Turkey, with our friends in Central Asia and Pakistan. And I'm glad that this is an opportunity for us to come up with new ideas to see where our the areas that we can expand cooperation. So those are my remarks on the energy in Afghanistan and the regional aspect of it. But a little bit, if I may add about the political insecurity, we know that the security in Afghanistan is not good. And one factor, in fact, that is not allowing investment and not allowing the vast potentials and opportunities to be used as effectively as possible. And hopefully with the upcoming meeting in Istanbul that is scheduled to be sometime in April or maybe after Ramadan, I think with the peace and stability, I think the opportunities are vast. And I'm glad that a number of organizations, including yours, TESPAM, and the Turkey Council, as well as other regional organizations, are looking into how we can generate cooperation in this sector. We are very open in the government of Afghanistan to work closely with our brothers in Pakistan, here with our brothers in Turkey, with Central Asia, to expand cooperation in this very, very important important sector, given the need for energy in South Asia, including Pakistan. But also this brings us to the political aspect that this also requires, you know, political cooperation by all the countries, and we are ready to engage once again. Thank you very much for the opportunity. We here at the embassy are ready to engage and continue these discussions with you and other interested stakeholders to see how we can facilitate investment in the energy sector in Afghanistan and how to explore ideas to expand cooperation with Turkey as well as countries participant in this discussion. Thank you.
Thanks very much, dear Ambassador, for this nice speech. And also, as a petroleum and natural gas engineer, from that perspective, I have to mention that we expect a huge potential in oil and gas, new oil and gas discoveries in Afghanistan. Maybe gas is much more possible. However, maybe in deeper regions than the Turkmenistan by comparing like that. By the way, I would like to say welcome to Mr. Abzal, the Kazakhstan's ambassador. Now we are giving the floor to Ambassador Muhammad Seyrus Sejat Gazi.
Thank you very, very much for inviting me. My gratitude for first of all to TESPAM and the Ahmed Yesevi University for organizing this event and giving me an opportunity to speak on an issue that is of very great importance to Pakistan and at the same time also of relevance to the region as well and as well to Turkey. I will start with giving a short few comments on Pakistan's geo-economic potential and then we will go from there. As you all know, Pakistan is strategically located to become Asia's premier trade, energy, and transport corridor. It is also the gateway to the rich Central Asian states, the financially liquid Gulf states, and the economically advanced Far Eastern countries. This strategic advantage alone makes Pakistan a marketplace teeming with opportunities. Something about Pakistan's demographics. 55% of our population is below the age of 19, which bodes well for the long-term sustainable development of Pakistan and also the region. Pakistan has also a strong middle class. A large part of the workforce is proficient in English, hardworking and intelligent. Pakistan possesses a large pool of trained and experienced engineers, bankers, lawyers, other professionals, with many having international experience. The consumer market in the country is growing at a very fast pace, as for instance reflected by the tele-density, which has now reached more than 150 million. Pakistan's investment policy has been designed to provide a comprehensive framework for creating a conducive business environment for the attraction of foreign direct investment. Our policy, in fact, is the most liberal and the longest standing in all of South Asia. Pakistan's policy trends have been consistent. Liberalization, deregulation, privatization, and facilitation are its important cornerstones. Pakistan has also been registering significant strides in ease of doing business, probably the best improvement in the region in the last 2 years. Pakistan is stepping forward and offering its geo-economic location for consolidating global and regional economic forum, economic interests. The more we are interconnected, just to echo what dear brother Ramin said before me, that the more we are connected, the more we have stakes in each other's economic viability, the more politically stable and closer we will get. This energy cooperation is not just for the sake of economic development. It has a very significant dividend in bringing the countries of the region closer in terms of politics, in terms of bringing stability, and of course, bringing prosperity to everybody involved. Connectivity with the neighboring countries and beyond is a very important part of Pakistan's policies. In this regard, the ongoing energy projects in regional connectivity, including the Khasa 1000 and the Turkmenistan-Afghanistan-Pakistan-India gas pipeline, which Brother Ramin also referred to, are important projects. Pakistan and Afghanistan, being the natural link between Central Asian and Arabian Sea, offer immense opportunities for regional connectivity and mutual cooperation. We are advocating for peace in Afghanistan so that we could connect with Central Asia, and both our countries can gain the dividends of peace and stability, and to use our very unique geographic location for our benefit as well as that of the region. I will say a few words now about CPEC. Everybody has probably heard of this. The China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, CPEC, with an investment portfolio of almost $62 billion, entails greater connectivity and trade linkages between Pakistan and China through a network of communication, energy pipelines, and power generation projects. The geo-economic package offered by Pakistan includes participation to foreign investors in the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor also. So it's not just between Pakistan and China, but all the countries in the region, and in fact beyond, can also benefit from it. In all, we have about 22 special economic zones under this project. Four with state-of-the-art facilities and business ecosystems are already ready for investment. One SCZ in each province, and each SCZ is dedicated for investment in clusters of different sectors to facilitate ease of choice from the prospective investors in which they want to go and invest. Out of the 10 joint working groups of the CPEC, one exclusively focuses on energy. In the first phase of the CPEC projects, focus was on energy and infrastructure development. To mitigate power shortages, 22 energy projects with a total capacity of 17,000 megawatts have been planned until 2030. Now, in these days, this age of climate change, and speaking of sustainable energy, it is important that when we talk about energy, we move beyond the traditional concept of thermal energy and look at other possibilities also, and Pakistan is doing the same. We have a robust regulatory framework to attract investment in our alternate energy opportunities. There is a Pakistan Alternate Energy Development Board, AEDB, which governs these activities. For instance, to speak of wind, as part of the Energy Action Plan, the Alternate Energy Development Board of Pakistan has been tasked to increase the share of wind power in our overall energy mix to 5% by 2030. The AEDB is developing investment-friendly opportunities and several fast-track regimes for wind power projects to meet these targets. For instance, in the case of Pakistan, what incentives do we offer to the prospective investors? Guaranteed electricity purchase. We provide guaranteed access to the grid, and it is the responsibility of the purchaser who will give this access to the grid. Protection against political risk, attractive tariffs, carbon credits are available, no import duties on equipment, and exemption on income tax, withholding tax, and sale tax for a certain period of time. And this list is not exhaustive. Similarly, in solar, Pakistan, of course, you know, we are a very warm, hot country. Pakistan has some of the highest values of solar irradiance, with 8 to 9 hours of sunshine per day per year. And these are ideal climatic conditions for solar power generation. Pakistan is providing various models for investment in this sector. Assistance is being provided to energy services companies for setting up domestic and commercial solar plants in Pakistan. Fourth tier of our energy spectrum is, of course, the nuclear power. Pakistan has a good record, excellent record, in fact, of operating nuclear power safely and securely for over 5 decades. Currently, we have 6 operational nuclear power plants. A few days ago, in fact, Pakistan's biggest nuclear power plant, K2, was connected to the national grid. The 1100 megawatt plant will significantly increase the overall share of nuclear power in our energy mix. With an immaculate record of running nuclear power plants and an independent regulatory regime, Pakistan has a lot of experience to offer to other countries in this sector. Now I come to our cooperation in the energy field and broader economic field with Turkey. The excellent political, historical, and cultural relations between Pakistan and Turkey do not need any introduction. They serve as a fantastic springboard for bilateral investment in various areas, including the energy sector. More than 100 Turkish companies are already doing good business in Pakistan. Pakistan and Turkey are natural partners in a strategic economic relationship, as is envisaged in the Strategic Economic Framework, SEF, signed during President Erdogan's visit to Pakistan in February 2020. We see Turkey as a mature LPG market, and Pakistan desires to benefit from Turkish experience in the LPG sector in terms of sharing best practices, standardization of equipment, material being used in the LPG industry, regulation and standardization in terms of LPG refueling stations, and overall LPG regulatory regime and approaches. There are numerous opportunities for joint investment in oil and gas exploration and development, and these are being explored. Both sides are also collaborating in the area of energy efficiency. We are also encouraging Turkish companies for investment in revamping of Pakistan's existing refineries or setting up new refineries in the country. For exploration and production activities in Pakistan, bidding will be held in the near future, and we encourage our Turkish brothers and Turkish companies to acquire exploration blocks in Pakistan and embark upon exploitation and production of hydrocarbons, either independently or in joint venture with Pakistani public companies like the Oil and Gas Development Corporation Limited and Pakistan Pipelines Limited. Turkish companies are already in Pakistan. Zorlu Energy and Arçelik are big investors. Zorlu has set up a 56 megawatt wind farm at Jhimpir in Pakistan and has entered into commercial operation in 2013 and was the result of $151 million investment by Zorlu Energy. As the first wind farm to be realized via foreign investment in Pakistan, it supplies power to 350,000 houses. Zorlu also has an option to expand the plant's installed capacity up to 300 megawatts. It also received the award for the best renewable energy financing in Middle East by the Project Finance Journal in 2011. This is just the tip of the iceberg. Other companies can replicate Zorlu's success in Pakistan. You probably are also aware that one of the largest hydropower power projects in the world right now is the Diamir Bhasha hydropower project in Pakistan. We look forward to it adding 4,500 megawatts of electricity to our national grid. The Diamir Bhasha Dam Consultancy Group comprises 12 top-ranked national and foreign consulting firms, which include companies from Switzerland, United States, Great Britain, China, and from Turkey. Dolsar Engineering is one of the leading consultants for the project. Besides large hydro projects, there is also unlimited, in fact, possibilities for small and mini hydro projects, particularly in Pakistan's northern areas. And we also invite Turkish companies to have a look at those. We encourage also a more holistic approach towards investment in Pakistan, given that our regime, as I said earlier, is quite friendly and is quite conducive to attracting foreign investment. In conclusion, I can only say that we see Turkey as a natural partner in this process of economic transformation in Pakistan and in the region around it. The excellent Pakistan-Turkey relationship is a solid foundation for economic and investment cooperation between the two countries. Many Turkish companies are already doing business in Pakistan, and I would like to conclude by saying there is room for many more in Pakistan, and we welcome you to consider these opportunities. I again thank you for giving me this opportunity to share with you this brief profile of investment opportunities in Pakistan, and I look forward to listening to you and learning from your experience in this regard. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, dear ambassador, for this nice speech and overview about the country. We all know that Pakistan also has lots of energy potential, maybe mostly on renewable side. It's very important for the Turkish country, for the region. And in addition, maybe from the oil and gas side, we expect maybe additional gas reserves in Pakistan. Maybe we need much more investment in this area. In addition to the other Turkic countries, I would like to specially thank to Pakistan for his kind and bold attempts and discourses like three states and one nation during the Karabakh War. Thanks very much. I was planning to give the floor to our Kyrgyzstan ambassador, but Mr. Elman Nasirov is here and he is on the way to visit Quba for the Quba genocide. He is on the way, and maybe he will not be able to attend the complete program. Initially, by apologizing to Mr. Ambassador, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Elman Nasirov. And listen from the Azerbaijan side.
Aziz dostlar, hörmətli dostlarımız, qardaşlarımız, çox hörmətli konfransın bugünkü iştirakçıları, qatılımçılar, sizin hər birinizi salamlayıram və eyni zamanda üzrxahlıq edirəm ki, mən konfransı bir qədər öncə tərk etməli olacağım. Biliriz ki, bu günləri Azərbaycanlıların soyqırımı günüdür. Ulu Öndər Heydər Əliyev 1998-ci ildə 31 mart, bax bugünkü günü Azərbaycanlıların soyqırımı günü kimi elan edib. Və indi mən ermənilərin Azərbaycanlılara qarşı 1918-ci ildə Quba qəzasında törətdikləri bir soyqırım cinayəti ilə bağlı orada bizim bir görüşümüz olacaq, bir tədbir keçirəcəyik. 1918-ci ildə 16 min Azərbaycanlını, türkü, ermənilər Quba qəzasında məhv etmişdilər, soyqırma məruz qoymuşdular və təkcə Azərbaycanlı deyil, Azərbaycanlılar deyil, orada yahudiləri də öldürmüşdülər, gürcülər də var, başqa millətlərin nümayəndələri də var və bu günləri biz orada böyük bir görüş keçirmək planlaşdırırıq. O ki, qaldı enerji güvənliyi məsələlərinə, onu söyləmək istəyərdim ki, Azərbaycan bu günləri Avropanın enerji güvənliyində çox önəmli bir yer tutur. Xüsusilə də Cənub Qaz Dəhlizinin işə salınması ilə Azərbaycanın rolu daha da artıb. Bilirsiniz ki, Avropanın mega projesi sayılan Cənub Qaz Dəhlizi ildə 16 milyard kubmetr qazı Avropaya ötürməyi nəzərdə tutur və bu proses başlanıb və bundan 6 milyard kubmetrini qardaş Türkiyə dövləti bizdən alır. 10 milyard kubmetr qazı biz Avropa ölkələrinə ödəyirik, deməli biz göndəririk. Onları transit bizdən alırlar. Və onu da söyləyim ki, enerji təhlükəsizliyi, enerji güvənliyi Azərbaycan üçün nə deməkdir? Bunun mənası nədir? Enerji güvənliyi bu ilk növbədə Azərbaycan qazının müxtəlif çoxsaylı xətlərlə, boru xətləri ilə Avropa bazarına çatdırılması anlamındadır. Çeşitli boru xətləri ilə çatdırılması anlamındadır. Avropa ölkələri üçün isə enerji güvənliyi bu ilk növbədə enerji mənbələrinin çox çeşitli olmasıdır. Onlar istəyirlər ki, çoxlu mənbələrdən enerjini alsınlar. Məsələn, Avropa ölkələrinin bu günləri təxminən 500-550 milyard kubmetr qaza ehtiyacı var. Bunun təxminən ən yaxşı halda 150 milyard kubmetrini, 130 milyard kubmetrini Rusiya Federasiyasından alırlar. Və bu baxımdan monopolist dövlət, inhisarçı dövlət Rusiyadır. Azərbaycan isə bu prosesdə yeni oyuncudur və Avropa çox istəyir ki, Rusiyadan enerji asılılığını azaltsın, digər mənbələrdən qaz alsın və bu baxımdan Azərbaycanın da əhəmiyyəti böyükdür və biz Avropaya ilkin olaraq 10 milyard kubmetr qaz satacağıq, amma gələcəkdə bunun 37 milyard kubmetrə çatdırılması da planlaşdırılır. Və bu baxımdan bizim çox ciddi əməkdaşlığımız formalaşıb və bu prosesdə qardaş Türkiyə dövləti ilə bizim ilişkilərimiz çox sürətlə inkişaf edir və Türkiyə tranzit ölkə olaraq Azərbaycan qazının Avropaya çatdırılmasında çox önəmli rol oynayır. Bu baxımdan Azərbaycan, Gürcüstan, Türkiyə, bundan savayı Balqaristandır, Albaniya dövlətidir, Yunanistandır və İtaliya. Bax, bu dövlətlər, 7 dövlət ilə bizim bu istiqamətdə çox ciddi ilişkilərimiz artıq formalaşıb və bu da çox önəmlidir və hesab edirəm ki, bu siyasətin həyata keçirilməsi ilk növbədə Avropanın enerji güvənliyi probleminə çox ciddi, pozitiv, müsbət təsir göstərir. Eyni zamanda həm Azərbaycan dövlətinin, həm də qardaş Türkiyə dövlətinin maraqlarına xidmət edir. Bu, bizim üçün olduqca əhəmiyyətlidir, önəmlidir. Həm də bu proje ona görə baş tutdu ki, ilk növbədə azad rəqabət projesidir. Burada bu proje ona görə baş tutdu və bu proje ona görə reallaşa bildi ki, burada enerji, petrol, qaz siyasətin əlində bir alət olmadı. Nə zaman ki, petrol, qaz siyasətin əlində bir alət olur, o zaman orada problemlər yaşanır. O projelərin həyata keçməsi çox ciddi problemlərlə üzləşir. Amma Azərbaycan belə etmədi. Biz bu projeləri həyata keçirərkən buna bir dostluq, bir əməkdaşlıq projesi kimi baxdıq və bu heç bir dövlətin əleyhinə çevrilməyib. Bunu öncədən söyləmək istəyirəm. Və sonda bir daha konferans iştirakçılarını nəzərinə çatdırmaq istəyirəm ki, biz tarixi dövrə daxil olmuşuq, Azərbaycan dövləti. Vətən müharibəsində biz tarixi qələbə imza atmışıq. Torpaqlarımızın üzərində suveren hüquqlarımızı bərpa etmişik. Qarabağ artıq Azərbaycanındır. Və bu vətən müharibəsində bizim Ali Baş Komandanımız Cənab Prezident İlham Əliyevin komandanlığı altında Azərbaycanın şanlı ordusu tarixi zəfərə imza atdı və bu prosesdə və bizim tariximizin bu şanlı səhifəsini yazarkən biz bunu nəsillər gedəcək, yüzilliklər gələcək, minilliklər gələcək, heç zaman unutmayacaq ki, qardaş Türkiyə dövləti bizə çox böyük mənəvi və siyasi dəstək verdi. Hər zaman yanımızda oldu. Bunu heç bir zaman cocuqdan tutmuş, böyüyə qədər heç bir zaman heç kəs unutmaz. Eyni zamanda mən fürsətdən istifadə edib indi Pakistan dövlətinin ambasadoru, onun səfiri indi çıxış etdi. Pakistan dövlətinə təşəkkür edirəm ki, hər zaman Azərbaycanın yanındadır. Bugünə qədər də Ermənistan dövləti ilə heç bir diplomatik ilişkiləri yoxdur, heç bir siyasi əlaqələri yoxdur. Səbəb də bəllidir. Səbəb odur ki, Ermənistan qardaş, dost Azərbaycan ərazisini işğal etmişdir. Bax, bütün bunlara görə mən xüsusi təşəkkürümü edirəm. Və bir daha sizdən üzrxahlıq edirəm ki, mən artıq konferans tərk etməliyəm, o Quba soyqırımı ilə bağlı bir tədbirə qatılmalıyam. Bir daha hər birinizə təşəkkür edirəm və konferansın təşkilatçılarına da onlara xüsusi minnətdarlığımı və təşəkkürümü ifadə edirəm. Sizə uğurlar arzulayıram. Sağ olun.
Siz də sağ olun. Biz təşəkkür edirik, qiymətli Ermən müəllim. Bu güzəl sohbetiniz üçün. Siz yolunuza devam edəcəksiniz haliylə, yolcuya dur denməz. Önemli bir olay tabii. Hepimiz üzülerek yad ediyoruz, üzülerek ifade ediyoruz. Öte taraftan uzun süreden beri Karabağ yeniden Türk yurdu oldu. Bu hepimizin mutlulukla değerlendirdiği ve ifade ettiği bir husus. İnşallah I would like to invite all the colleagues and all the interested people to our 13B session. It's going to be mainly focused on the Karabağ region and the energy, ecology and the security side of Karabağ after this session. Let me continue with our Kyrgyzstan ambassador. Their ambassador, the floor is yours. Thanks very much.
Good morning again to everyone. Thank you very much for giving this kind of opportunity to talk about our energy potential in our country. And I would like to just pay attention before to give some slight show in our presentation, and also to our colleagues, especially to Afghan and Pakistan, my colleagues, to about Kasab 1000 project. This is also a very important project, which is participating in Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. Okay, let me see now share.
Yeah, here. It's open now. You can open the slide.
Did you see? Some slides.
We see your screen now. You have to open the presentation.
Okay. Did you able to see?
It's blank now. We cannot see your presentation. You have to put the presentation as full screen. Or as the other option, you can cancel the...
Yeah, just give me 1 second. Yeah.
Okay, no problem. We have time. While we are organizing this, let me play an arts video while we are organizing the sharing screen. Let's watch as a break.
Did you see? Wow. Ambassador.
Yeah, we see it now. It's okay now. Please.
Yeah, but this first slideshow is about our country, some data bus, but just I would like to pay attention for you know, the hydropower, our potential. Now is our potential is 142 billion kilowatt hours. And the, right now we're using only 10% of this potential. The, so we have 90% of not yet use it. And the, so this is also giving this number how our potential is very high and the also in the investment opportunities. And the second slide is yeah, as you can see, this is also general hydropower potential is in 142.5 million, but it is possible to construct in the in our Narun River. This is the main river, which is actually is our Cascades, to make it located. But seven Cascades and the 27 hydropower plants. And the, this is totally the 20 billion kilowatt hours is today is using. And the perspective our projects and the, is preparing our national energy holdings and the construction in, of Upper Narun Cascade is you know, the HP is power 237.7 the megawatts and the construction period is 5 years and the, as you see you can able see in our in this slideshow all is details in the including this project amounts and the so cost of this each projects and the of course, and the how can and many this project developments also, and the, of course, and they will be forward to you this whole presentation, and the, you can share to with our participants in for this conference. And the is marketing and the. Is also, as you know, for investors very important and the growing for is also billions kilowatt megawatt for hours. And the is as you see in this diagram is 2017 how much was in the is in, you can see in 2023 it will be how much. This is the Kyrgyz Republic is, has this high potential also renewable energy sources that is estimated as 840.2 million tons of reference in fuel per year. The main types of NAC, like renewable energy sources in the country are solar energy, small water and the stream energy, wind energy too, and the and also the water energy, and the, of course, and the also the, we using a dual mass, pure mass energy too. Yeah, is the project implementation roadmap. For obligation of the government of the Kyrgyz Republic and the National Energy Holding, but today we are just as you know, after new cabinet, we just create Minister of Energy, and the, so all of these energy sectors under our Minister of Energy, and the, this also you can see able to our. Is opportunities in the is Once again, I would like to pay attention this for CASA 1000 project. And this is, as you can see in the map, this is starting from Kyrgyzstan. And, also, this is summer period time. Usually, this, we have like in Kyrgyzstan and the Tajikistan. And from Kyrgyzstan is his name is Datka, and to Tajikistan is Khurjan. This is total is 477 kilometers from Kyrgyzstan to Tajikistan. And after, of course, to go to Afghanistan and to Pakistan is final point. And this is promising markets for electricity is will for very few futures. So once again, if you can, we talk is about our is this is main generating capacities right now, and is again this is more high water energy is most is from Narin rivers, and as again, I would like to more pay attention right now is using only 10% of our potential. So taking this opportunity, I would like to invite all potential investors to come to Kyrgyzstan and to start together this and our future this kind of energy is really one of the now is becoming more important because fuel and the others energy is this is also is not more positive for climate change and this our hydroelectric energy is in the future not only for our region and the world. So if you have any question, I am ready to give an answer to all of you. And, thank you very much again for this kind of opportunity. And, yeah, this is to finish my presentation. So I hope you can able see something.
Thanks very much, dear Ambassador.
Thank you, Ambassador. Very, very good presentation. Next time I'll do the same.
So I have just cut for this is, of course, many slideshow was, but mainly I just show for 5 or 6, which is important in the,
very good.
To our colleagues and for investors. We'll be forward to all this presentation, and you can also can share to our for participants and to can to your webpage or something.
Of course, we will upload this presentation to our website. Inshallah, we will do like that. Thanks very much for this nice presentation. Kyrgyzstan is very important for the region and for the Turkish world, mainly as we understand from the water security side. All these hydrothermal and hydrogen power plants are important, and new investments for the dams are very important to be able to block much and much more water volumes. And in the future, we are expecting with the climate change, less water resources in the region. Of course, we have oil and gas, but water is one of the other important items for the whole region. In this concept, the importance of Kyrgyzstan increases much and much more for the further processes. Thanks very much for this presentation. Maybe while a huge bank or a fund, maybe if we can found in this concept, this fund may invest For example, for oil in Kazakhstan, gas in Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan, maybe for hydro power centrals and water resources for dams in Kyrgyzstan and maybe in Pakistan, and maybe for Afghanistan some mines and gas resources. Thanks very much. I would like to give the floor to our Kazakhstan ambassador, Mr. Abzal. Thanks very much. The ambassador, floor is yours.
Excellencies, ambassadors, ambassador of Kyrgyzstan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and also I am sending my great salute to my old friend who is now in Tashkent. With your permission, I prepared my speech in Turkish, so let me continue my statement in Turkish. Değerli Resmen Başkanı Oğuzhan Akener, değerli katılımcılar, değerli büyükelçiler, öncelikle Uluslararası Türk Enerji Birliği Kongresi'nin enerji alanında işbirliği ve yatırım fırsatları kapanış özel oturumuna davet ettiğiniz için teşekkür ederim. Hepinize saygıyla selamlıyorum. Bildiğiniz üzere Kazakistan petrol, doğalgaz, uranyum ve kömür başta olmak üzere doğal kaynaklarıyla dünyadaki zengin ülkelerden biridir. Dolayısıyla ülkemiz için enerji konusu öncelik arz etmektedir. Bu bakımdan çeşitli bilim ve iş adamlarını, konu üzerine araştırma yapan uzmanları bir araya getiren bu kongre oldukça önemlidir. 2020 yılı petrol rezervlerine göre ülkeler sıralamasında Kazakistan 30 milyar varil hacmiyle dünyada 11. sırada yer aldı. Yine 2020 yılı verilerine göre Kazakistan petrol üretiminde ilk 10 ülkeden birisidir. 2020 yılında Kazakistan 85.7 milyon ton petrol üretti. Yani kaba şekilde 86 milyon ton petrol üretti. Ve bunun 68.5 milyon tonunu ihraç etti. 15.8 milyon tonunu işlerken 11.5 milyon tonunu petrol ürünlerini üretimde kullandı. Kazakistan'ın önümüzdeki 10 yıllık hedefinde bu 85 milyon ton petrol üretiminde en az 1,5-2 kata çıkarma hedefi vardır. Doğalgaz alanında gelecek olursak Kazakistan 2020 yılında 55.1 milyar metreküp doğalgaz üretti. Bunun 10.7 milyar metreküpü ihraç edildi. Uranyum üretiminde Kazakistan 2020 yılında 19.586 ton uranyum üreterek dünyada üretilen uranyumun %42'sini oluşturmuştur. Kazakistan petrol ve doğal gazı sadece ihraç etmekle yetinmemektedir. Bunun yanı sıra petrokimya alanının gelişmesine de önem vermektedir. Örneğin 2020 verilerine göre petrokimya üretim hacmi %155 oranında artarak 360 bin tona ulaşmıştır. Bunun %80'i ihraç edilmiştir. Halihazırda ülkemizde 870 bin tonluk kapasiteyle aromatik hidrokarbonlar, polipropilen, motor yağlar gibi çeşitli üretimler mevcuttur. 2025 yılına kadar petrokimya ürünlerinin üretimini en az 5.5 kat artırarak 2 milyon tona kadar çıkarmayı hedefliyoruz. 2020 yılında Kazakistan toplam olarak 108 milyar kilowatt saat elektrik üretti. Ülke ihtiyaçlarının %100 karşıladı. Ayrıca 866 milyon kilowatt saat elektriği de ihracat etti. Malumunuz Kazakistan'da birçok dünya şirketleri, işte Chevron, Total, Eni, Lukoil, CNPC, Shell gibi devlerin Kazakistan'daki başarılı yatırımları var ve onlar yatırımlarda devam etmektedir. Kıymetli katılımcılar, Kazakistan'ın çok vektörlü dış politikası enerji politikamızla uyumlu olduğuna dikkat çekmek istiyorum. Dış politikada bölgesel ve küresel aktörlerle eşit mesafede dengeli politika geliştirdiğimiz gibi enerji politikamızda da ihracat yollarını çeşitlendirmeye çalışmaktayız. Bu politika aynı zamanda ulusal güvenlik konularıyla da yakından bağlantılıdır. Halihazırda Kazakistan kendi enerji kaynaklarını 4 güzergah üzerinden ihracat etmektedir. Rusya rotası öncelikli güzergah olmaya devam etmektedir. Çin istikameti ihracatımızın önemli bölümünü kapsamaktadır. İran güzergahı özellikle doğalgaz ihracatımızda önemli yere sahiptir. Bunların yanı sıra Hazar üzerinden Baku-Tiflis-Ceyhan hattı bizim önceliklerimizin arasındadır. Bu koridor bir yandan enerji ihracat yollarını çeşitlendirmesi ve diğer yandan Türk Keneşi üye ülkeleri arasındaki işbirliğinin geliştirilmesi bakımından stratejik öneme sahiptir. Değerli dostlar, Kazakistan petrol ve doğalgaza zengin ülke olmasına rağmen karbon ve hidrokarbon enerji sektörü, daha doğrusu fosil ve hidrokarbon enerji sektörüne bağımlılığını azaltmaya çalışmaktadır. Kazakistan Cumhurbaşkanı Kasım Jomart Tokayev'in geçen sene Birleşmiş Milletler Genel Kurulu'nun 75. oturumundaki konuşmasında açıkladığı üzere Kazakistan fosil yakıtlara oldukça bağımlı olmasına rağmen karbondan arındırılmış bir ekonomi geliştirme taahhüdünde bulunmaktadır. Ayrıca Kazakistan ekonomik revizyon ve endüstriyel modernizasyonu ile sera gazı emisyonlarının 2030 yılına kadar %5 oranında azaltacaktır. Bu bağlamda yeşil enerji konusu hükümetimizin öncelikli politikalarından biridir. Kazakistan 2050 stratejisi ve yeşil enerjiye geçiş belgesi bu alandaki hedeflerimizi ortaya koymaktadır. 2014-2020 yılları arasında ülkemize yenilenebilir enerji alanında 1.5 milyar dolar yatırım yapıldı. Halihazırda toplam gücü 1635 megawatt 43 güneş enerji santrali, 29 rüzgar santrali, 5 biyogaz tesisi, 30 su santrali olmak üzere toplam 115 yenilenebilir santral çalışmaktadır. Bu projeleri dünyanın çeşitli 12 ülkesinin yatırımcıları hayata geçirdi. 2020 verilerine göre geçen sene yenilenebilir enerji %133.3 oranında artmıştır. Ancak yenilenebilir enerjinin toplam ülke enerji üretimindeki oranı şimdilik %3 oranındadır. Bu oran 2025 yılına kadar %6, 2030 yılına kadar %10 ve 2050 yılına kadar %50 oranına çıkartma hedefimiz vardır. Çünkü yenilenebilir enerjide Kazakistan'ın büyük potansiyeli vardır. Ülkemizin rüzgar enerjisi yıllık 920 milyar kilowatt, güneş enerjisinde yıllık 2,5 milyar kilowatt, hidroelektrikte yıllık 62 milyar kilowatt ve jeotermalde yıllık 4.3 kilowatt potansiyelimiz olduğu tahmin edilmektedir. Yenilenebilir enerji sektörüne yatırım yapanlara hükümetimiz önemli ayrıcalıklar tanımakta ve teşvikler vermektedir. Yatırımcılara ithalatta gümrük ve KDV vergilerinde muafiyet, ayrıca 10 yıllığına kadar kurumlar ve arazi vergilerinden 8 yıllığına kadar emlak vergisinden muafiyet sağlamaktadır. Ek olarak yatırımcılar için altyapısı hazır, ücretsiz arazi tahsil edilir. Ayrıca 15 yıl süreyle garantili elektrik alımı, tesisin bir yıllık işletiminden sonra yıllık tarife endekslemesi, yani %70 döviz bazında, %30 enflasyon bazında fiyat garantisi vermekte. Bunların hepsi Kazakistan'da yenilenebilir enerji alanında yatırım yapmak için cazip ülke haline getirmektedir. Tabii önümüzde bazı değişiklikler yapılacak. 15 yıllık garanti süresini 20 yıla kadar uzatma gibi şu anda değişiklikler öngörülmektedir. Kazakistan'da 2020 yılındaki yenilenebilir enerji kaynakları için 1 kilowatt karşılığı garantili tarifler şöyledir. Rüzgar satın alma fiyatı 5.1 sent, güneş 4 sent, hidroenerji 3.6 sent olarak belirlenmiştir. Sonuç olarak Kazakistan'ın enerji politikası zamanında ruhuna uygun ve Birleşmiş Milletler'in sürdürülebilir kalkınma hedefleriyle uyumlu bir şekilde gelişmektedir. Sözüme son verirken bu kongrenin Kazakistan ve Türk dünyasının ve bölgemizin, Avrasya bölgemizin enerji potansiyelini daha iyi değerlendirmesine ve bu konuda birlik olmamıza vesile olacağına inancımı belirtmek isterim. Ve Kazakistan'ın yenilebilir enerji sektörüne yatırım yapmaya davet ediyorum. Teşekkür ederim.
Biz teşekkür ederiz Sayın Büyükelçim. Bu güzel konuşma için, değerlendirme için. Genelde yenilenebilir enerjiye ağırlık yaptınız. Of course, renewable energy is important for the Turkic countries and for the region. However, I usually mention as a petroleum and natural gas engineer and while studying, maybe I'm going to show a short video regarding with our long-term oil and gas demand projections for the globally. I'm going to do it before maybe I apologize to Mr. Cemalettin Tuney before his speech. I'm going to show a short video regarding with the long-term projections. I would like to mention that Kazakhstan has lots of oil resources, and I think with the new investments, those resource potential maybe increase up to higher, maybe to the doubled and tripled to such high levels. Investment is needed in the region, and for example, our estimations that up to 2050s, Kazakhstan is going to gain additional 300,000 barrels per day oil export potential and plus 8 BCM gas export potential. But I have to mention that for the gas flare systems, Kazakhstan has to invest much more. Hence, currently producing much of its gas from the associated resources, like it's coming from the oil reservoir, and in this regard, it is burning nearly 60% of produced gas and flared it. This is this sector has an additional investment opportunity for the investors. I have to mention before coming to Mr. Cemalettin's speech, I would like to show you TESBAMS a short global energy projection. Thanks very much for watching the short video. We have prepared long-term projections globally for all of us, and gas becoming much more important for the region. And also, I have to mention again, water is another important issue. And Mr. Ambassador, as mentioned in his speech, nuclear and nuclear potential and uranium potential is another important resource material in the region. Now, by mentioning the importance of gas, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Cemalettin Tuney, the TİKA representative in Uzbekistan, and also he is our advisory board member. Mr. Cemalettin, the floor is yours. I think you are going to make the presentation in Turkish.
Actually, I didn't decide so far, but with regard to His Excellency's, my brothers, Abdal Sefer Bekulu Bey, Muhammed Sirus Kazi Bey, they are all my friends. When I was in Turkey, now in being in Tashkent, I have to start with the Uzbek, but a very nice Muslim way. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for inviting me this kind of very nice opportunity where I have an opportunity to meet my friends, the ambassadors. Also, the existing ambassadors are all presided my former friends, for example, Ibrahim Yunusoğlu Bey, the former Kyrgyz ambassador, now being in Tashkent, we are having very nice relation here. Also, Esat Gilani, the former undersecretary of the Pakistan embassy in Ankara, now the ambassador of Pakistan to the Tashkent, Uzbekistan, now also here. So I am very happy. At the on the other hand, I had very nice relation with the former Afghani ambassador Abdulrahim Saidjan, but for the timing I have no chance to meet current ambassadors in Turkey. I have to extend my regards to them and wish a very nice and pleasant stay during their stay in Turkey. Actually, I'm now in Tashkent. I like to look from Tashkent where the energy panorama of the Central Asia and the world with relation to Turkey and Turkish world, how it looks like. But let me start with the Uzbek facts and the basic data. Where I can extend my comments over cooperation among the Turkish nations and the subcontinent countries, as well as integration of the Central Asia to the world market through the ways and the lines towards from east to west or east to from center to the east, I mean to China. As I mentioned that I am now in TİKA, in a different institution, organization of Turkey, and based in Tashkent. I like to highlight a little bit Uzbekistan outlook of energy. Uzbekistan is one of the most populous country in Central Asia, around 34 million people, and 2.5 million people live in its capital city, Tashkent. And it is oil, coal, and the uranium rich country. Oil gas rich country. It ranks, for example, in terms of natural gas, 11th in the world. For the mining, it is the 14th in the world. And for in terms of uranium, it is the 6th in the world. And also, it is the world leader for producing and supplying reserves of certain minerals such as gold, copper, phosphates, and molybdenum. It has almost all elements in the periodical scale available in this country. It has developing country, its income per capita is still low, but on the way to increase, rapidly increasing. And it is an emerging market full of potential and opportunities for investment. When we come to the energy, Uzbekistan suffers, it has some opportunities, pros, but at the same time, it has some contrasts in terms of aging infrastructure in gas distribution system and power distribution lines. They are almost out of date, need to be repaired and renewed, but it's updating is very slow. That's why it is a problem that we face in the winter time, several interruptions, power blockades, blackouts, I mean, and also inadequate supply of the natural gas. This is one negative side of the Uzbekistan energy outlook, but it has great potential underground and in terms of growing demands. It has many potentials. It has potential to meet the growing demand, but in order to produce, generate the energy, it needs foreign investment because the country is deficient in finance and it needs foreign investors to come. At the same time, this country also lacks the energy efficiency because of the aging energy infrastructures. The efficiency is a big problem. The Minister of Energy stated that yearly Uzbekistan consumes almost equal to Turkish natural gas consumption, but Turkey heats or generates the energy for 83 million people, whereas Uzbekistan generates the energy same amount of out of the same amount of natural gas for the people of 34 million. This is how the system is inefficient. As I told you, Uzbekistan is one of the largest natural gas producer. It annually produces 60 billion cubic meters, and almost 80% are consumed domestically, and the rest is sold to Russia, China, and there are some projects connecting to Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. But because of the inefficiency in the oil natural gas extraction, it faces some of shortages, especially the problem, the shortages become acute within the last 2 and 3 years. There was some supply disruption. Some part of the cities were not heated and the people become unhappy with that. Also, it has a petroleum, but its refining industry is not that much efficient. So it imports mainly from the Kazakhstan. As an individual observation, the quality of gas from Kazakhstan is highly appreciated by the Uzbek drivers. They prefer the Kazakh gasoline diesel. Whereas if the gas station offers the Uzbek oil and gas, they prefer Kazakh ones. So for the energy outlook, it also big reserves of the coal, almost 4 billion tons of coal's available, approved reserves, but it needs to be extracted. So in this regard, it has also, it needs investment, of course, from the outside. I mentioned a little bit, since the early 2000s, Uzbekistan has been exporting 10 to 15 billion metric cube of natural gas to China, to Russia and Kazakhstan, and 500 million cubic meters to other Central Asian countries. On the top of its domestic oil production, Uzbekistan imports additional crude oil for its refineries. Around 30% of the total output is imported from Kazakhstan, mainly Kazakhstan. Refining output satisfies the domestic market demand, but small quantities exported. But the quality of the refinery products are still low. That means the refining infrastructure needs to be updated. Uzbekistan's most important export destination for energy commodities are China, Russia, and Kazakhstan. And there are projects, including Turkmenistan, connecting Uzbekistan to Afghanistan and to subcontinent countries, Pakistan and India. The energy consumption by sector, the data that I received from the Open Resources International Energy Agency, the 40% goes to industry sector, whereas the population, the people consumes 23% of the total energy outlook. Energy generation. Agriculture is 20%, and the utility, the other utilities consumes 13%. Uzbekistan now trying to diversify its energy generation sources and to comply with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, where by that policy, it needs to, it plans to increase the share of renewable energy sources in the general energy outlook. In this regard, they adopted a big investment and promotion scheme to attract foreign and domestic investors in the solar energy and the wind energy. This is my individual observation. I listened from the Turkish investors who came here to understand the potentials and pay a visit to me. They were unhappy with the purchase guarantee parity, that is $1.2 is considered very low for the Turkish entrepreneurs. But I followed through to the media, the Gulf countries investors, mainly from United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia, were planning to make big investments in solar energy and the wind energy. The government wants to increase its share, the renewable energy share, whereas it is now 3%, to 13% in the coming years. By that, they need almost $5 billion US dollar worth of investment in 10 years period. This is also good potential for the investors. On the other hand, Uzbekistan, as an ex-Soviet country, needs to have a liberalized market, energy markets.
they want to have an they want to get access to the experience of Turkish case, where Turkey adopted the liberal market energy markets since 2001. And I met the authorities from the energy ministry. They like to adopt Turkish experience and establish a liberal market energy markets, that is petroleum market, natural gas and electricity. And they want to enhance, develop, and create a conducive environment for investors in terms of liberal market experience. And that's why they are now in the edge of eve of the big energy reforms, adoption of big changes to create energy markets. So being spent several years in the energy sector in Turkey, in the government, in the Ministry of Energy, and also EMRA, Energy Market Regulatory Authority, I also like to be given advice how to design their way. But let me come to the investment opportunities. In the beginning, I told you Uzbekistan needs energy intensity. The energy consumption per capita is still very low, according to the in accordance with the world average level. So in terms of to achieve its economic development goals, it needs a huge amount of investment, but domestic financing capacity is not enough, so they invite the foreign investors. In this regard, I follow from personal personally, and also happen to see from the media that the many foreign investors are visiting, and the announcement of new projects or the groundbreaking ceremonies announced in the media, such as Turkish companies Cengiz Inşaat and AXA Energy. Now they are already awarded four different separate, I mean, power generation unit, natural gas combined cycle power plant. Cengiz Inşaat has 1,200 megawatt, whereas AXA is around 500 megawatt power generation capacity. And I also heard that the French companies are also has a great interest in investing energy markets, energy sector. And the EU, United Arab Emirates companies are also investing in solar energy, natural gas power plants. So in the coming future, the Uzbekistan needs big investors and then and the investment in order to attain its development goals. That's why it is very open to the foreign investors, to Turkish entrepreneurs and other entrepreneurs from the region. This is what I want to tell about Uzbekistan. But as an individual interest, this area, I mean the Central Asia, great potential, as Mr. Abdal Sefer Kulubey declared, stated that both Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and other countries in the region has a big producing volumes and also big potential and big reserves, and they need to access the world market through via South Corridor. I'm talking about in terms of Central Asia, to reach Indian Ocean, to west through Caspian Sea, or through the Kazakhstan and Caspian Sea, to reach BTC and TANAP natural gas power line, the natural gas lines. I mean, there are many opportunities for integration and to reach the world market. They need to the natural gas, oil, also need to reach the seaborne shores. So there are the options, but these projects are mega projects. Need to be multinational and multi-billion investment scheme, which makes a little bit more difficult and more elaborate to realize. And the energy in this regard constitutes a great base for integration of the Turkish world and Muslim world, since if they remunerate their potential and able to sell, export their production to the world market, they will develop or they will finance their development projects and increase the well-being of their population, and this will affect the Turkish world. And then we are very hopeful in this regard, since in the international arena, in terms of diplomatic relations and economic relations, this area constitutes very good potential area and needs to be elaborated. So there are in this session, we have the ambassadors, the diplomats, the key persons in this regard, being very well aware of this fact. So it is mainly their duties as in the kitchen to pave the ways for further and realization of these projects. Let me stop here. Thank you for your attention to me. I hope I will be very beneficial too. And thank you, Oğuzhan, my old colleague from the same university. And you let me meet Mr. Kazi, my brother, Abzal Bey, my schoolmate. But I had no opportunity to meet the ambassador of Afghanistan and ambassador of Kyrgyzstan. But your former colleagues were welcome. My friends.
Welcome. Then to get to know each other, inshallah.
Yes, exactly, inshallah. But we are now in your region, in Tashkent. So, but this is very friendly, very warm atmosphere. Thank you for your attention. Thank you, Oğuzhan. Please.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much. I would like to thank
Ambassador. Just quick one comment about, you know, just to, first of all, thank you very much. Very good presentation about Uzbekistan opportunity. I will go tell to my colleague in here, Alisher Bey, how is this, you know, is TIKA representative coordinator is make presentation about Uzbek's energy potential opportunity. But as you know, all of you, just 20 days ago, our president have state visit to Tashkent. And
yes.
During this trip, and the two both leaders was agreed to jointly implement. One is our big project, Kambarata 1. This is also, you know, as you mentioned, Ambassador, mega billion, almost $2 billion, you know, the amount of this project. So before, of course, our leader to propose to President of Kazakhstan also, and to Tokayev Jomart, and the to before, and the to Russian side also too. We are open to everyone. So if you you would like to please, I during my presentation I mentioned about we just using only 10% of our potential. So 90% is please welcome.
Excellency, I have a very keen interest to Kyrgyzstan. It was my first country to pay attention because in 1992 I host the Kyrgyz students in Ankara University. Because of that, I have the Kyrgyzstan has a special place in my heart. Don't forget. So I am not representing my ticker, but I have former experience in the energy market. I mean, in Ministry of Energy, I spent 7 years there, and 12 years in EMRA before joining the Grand National Assembly and before joining TIKA. That's why Osan wants to exploit my former experience. I am now representing not TIKA, but myself. That is the case. Just I'd like to tell you, let you know. But at the same, you remind me of one thing that the leadership in this region are very nice. There are some potential, the conflict potentials, especially the border problems and the water sharing. But with the wise mentality of the leaders, these problems are overcome with a good manner, very peaceful, which is our tradition. Our Turkish tradition forces us to cooperate in this regard. I closely followed the visit of His Excellency, the President of Kyrgyzstan, to here. So it made a big joy among the people of Uzbekistan. It was celebrated. So many areas of potential dispute were solved, and this is very nice. In the former case, in the previous times, also they were all achieved in a peaceful manner. So these are we are all brothers, and then with our tradition of cooperation and the brotherhood, we are able to solve our problems without any extending the problems. That's why I like to thank the leaders of both country in this regard. It is very exemplary stand in solution of the bilateral problems. Thank you, Dad.
Çok teşekkürler. Ankara'da görüşürüz.
İnşallah, inşallah. I will tell you your greetings to hemen selamlarınızı İbrahim Akam'a söyleyeceğim hocam.
Söylemiz, yeah. İbrahim. Not only to Ibrahim, to all of our Uzbek friends, please say hello.
Evet, evet. Cumhurbaşkanı Bey, Ankara'da görüşürüz inşallah.
İnşallah, inşallah Sayın Büyükelçi. Ben çok teşekkür ederim.
Biz teşekkür ederiz.
Ben de bütün büyükelçilerime, Cemalettin Bey'e katılan ve ayrılmak zorunda olan Erman Bey'e, yine aramızda olamayan Abdullah Çalışkan Bey'e, şu an Covid sebebiyle hastanede yatıyor. Tekrar kendisine geçmiş olsun dileklerimizi iletiyoruz. Yani şu an elimizden dua etmek geliyor kendileri için sadece. Moderatörümüz Hulusi Bey de acil bir toplantı için katılamadı. Özürlerini beyan etti. Türkçe olarak artık başta vurgulamıştım, tekrar vurgulayayım. Ona da selamlarımızı iletiyoruz. Arzu Hanım'ın bir sorusu var. Bizim Arzu Hanım da bizim kongre koordinasyon ekibimizden. Gençlere yönelik enerji birliği adına online eğitimler verilmesiyle alakalı Kazakistan Büyükelçimize yöneltmiş ama sanırım genel bir soru ya da bir öneri, yorum gibi. Hani bu konuda da yorum yapmak isteyen varsa alabiliriz. Sonrasında da son sözlerinizi alıp programı bitirelim inşallah. Evet. Mrs. Arzu is a member of our organization team for the Congress and also a member of TESPAM. She asked about online education and training programs regarding with energy integration and mainly on the renewable energy side. Maybe the embassies may help regarding with these opportunities. She asked like that.
Galiba bana sormuş galiba değil mi Özkan Bey?
I think the question size geldi.
Ama gerçekten işin uzmanı olmamakla beraber şöyle diyebilirim. Kazakistan'da biliyorsunuz 3,5 senedir, artık 4. seneye gidiyor. Astana Uluslararası Finans Merkezi faaliyet göstermekte. Astana Uluslararası Finans Merkezi bu İngiliz ve Galler hukukuna ve İngilizce olarak faaliyet gösteren bir uluslararası merkez. Bunun kendi anayasal bağımsız statüsü var. Ve bu finans merkezinin ana maksatlarının birisi de finans alanında yatırım çekmek. İşte hedge fondlar, varlık fonu, işte şahsi fonlar. Bunun bünyesinde uluslararası İpek Yolu Borsası çalışmakta. Tabii ki bir de tahkim merkezi ve uluslararası mahkeme de var. 17 tane uluslararası hakimlerden oluşan. Bir de bunun finans merkezinin bir diğer özelliği de yenilebilir enerji alanında da yatırım çekmek. Bünyesinde yeşil enerji kurumu çalışıyor. O da yine finans merkezinin içinde ama yine kendi uluslararası statüsü olan. Aslında yani neden olmasın, bu finans merkezinin bir yani yatırım çekmekle beraber yatırım alanında da özellikle yenilebilir enerji alanında eğitim ve çeşitli seminer, öğretici, işte know-how paylaşım, tecrübe paylaşım gibi faaliyetler yapmaktır. Aslında yani onlarla temasa geçip bu konuda bir eğitim semineri düzenlenebilir diye düşünüyorum.
Çok teşekkür ederim. Bu alanda inşallah program sonunda tek tek bütün büyükelçiliklerimizde de temas kurup özel bu alanda ortak çalışma imkanlarımızı geliştirebileceğimiz toplantılar düzenleriz. İnşallah we are going to make some meetings with the embassies to increase our joint studies in this area in the regarding with the energy integration and in addition investment we are trying to found with Başarsoft, an important software company in Turkey. We are now preparing a software which is handling all the energy and social data and economical data at the same ground. We will inform you about these activities. Inshallah. Let me finish my words and we completed our session time. I would like to get your final words again for from everyone. In Turkish, we say them yürek sözü. I have heard this in Azerbaijan. Let's start with the upper. Let's start with Mr. Cemalettin today, and step by step, let me get your last words and then finish the Congress. Thanks for attending.
Ben bu sefer Türkçe konuşayım. Hepinize katkılarınız ve sunumlarınız için çok teşekkür ederim. Ben de istifade ettim. Buradan dünyaya bakmak farklı bir duygu. Şu ana kadar, yani bu zamana kadar Türkiye'den, Avrupa'dan merkezli bir bilgi akışıyla dünyaya bakıyorduk ama Orta Asya'dan dünyaya bakmak farklı bir tecrübe oldu benim için. Ben bu manada Sayın Büyükelçilerimizin ülkeleri perspektifinde yaptıkları sunumlardan çok istifade ettim. Bizi dinleyen ve bu ülkelerde yatırım fırsatları arayanlar için güzel aydınlatıcı fikirler oldu. Yine de sizlerin özellikle üzerinde durmaya çalıştığınız Türk dünyasında enerji temelinde bir işbirliği imkanlarının geliştirmesi açısından da bu tür süreçler, bu tür konferanslar bir bilgi birikimi, bir farkındalık, bir şuur kazanmasına vesile olmaktadır. Ben muhterem büyükelçilerimizin değerli vakitlerini ayırarak bu toplantıya katılmalarını ve bizlere bilgilerini, tecrübelerini istifademize sunmalarından dolayı onlara teşekkür ederim. İnşallah biz de onlara faydalı olmuşuzdur. Yine Abzal Bey, Mr. Kadi, Mr. Ambassador Kuban Beyçek Bey, muhterem Büyükelçim, Afganistan Büyükelçim, bizler burada dahi olsak ülkelerinizin hizmetinize hazırız. Ben her zaman Özbekistan'da olmam bir mesele değildir. Hepinizin ülkelerini ben ayrı ayrı seviyorum. Tarihsel bağlantılarımız konusunda işte bir Afganistan'a gidemedim. İnşallah onu da görmek istiyorum. Kırgızistan'da çok arkadaşım var. Bu anlamda sizlere burada da olsun, Türkiye'ye döndüğümde de olsun her zaman hizmette bilgimiz varsa onları hizmetinize sunmaya hazırız. Bu konuda da herhangi bir şeyiniz, tereddüdünüz olmasın. Bizi bir dost, bir kardeşiniz olarak bilmenizi isterim. Ben teşekkür ederim.
Teşekkür ederiz Cemalettin Bey. Müsaitseniz Abzal Bey sizden son yürek sözünüzü alalım.
Öncelikle bugünkü aşağı yukarı herhalde 3 gündür devam eden başarılı bir enerji spesifik konudaki bu toplantıyı organize eden başta Oğuzhan Bey sizlere teşekkür ederim. Bu alanda ve Türk özellikle Türk dünyası işbirliği alanda yaptığınız çalışmaları gerçekten takdir ediyorum. Hiç boş durmuyorsunuz. Neredeyse her hafta bir programınız var. Söyleyişleri var. İnşallah bu pandemi bitmesiyle daha böyle yüz yüze toplantılar yapma yapacağınıza inanıyorum. Değerli büyükelçilerimizi de dear ambassadors, also thank you very much for your kind and important contribution. We learned much about your country policy in the energy sector, and I hope not only among the Turkic world and the greater space in Eurasia, we will continue our cooperation, especially in energy sector. Today's technology is providing this such kind of the contribution. I mean the producing energy in Kazakhstan by swapping it, exporting to neighboring countries and exporting it to the most needed countries. So I think energy is still the one of the driving power of the states and the region's development. We have a huge potential, not only the classic traditional energy sector, but as you see in Kyrgyzstan presentation, in Afghanistan presentation, we have a huge potential in the renewable energy sector. The world is going to this direction, so we have to catch this trend. And thank you very much for my old and the good friend Cemalettin Bey. He is the on the heart of the region, I mean the greater Eurasian region in Central Asia. I hope he enjoy his business and his life in Tashkent. Please transmit our greetings and salute to our old friend. Thank you very much for participating. Thank you for all the listeners, contributors who asking our questions and making their contribution in organizing this event. Thank you very much.
Teşekkür ederiz. Şimdi de kıymetli Büyükelçimiz Kubanıç Bey'e sözü verelim. Buyurun Sayın Büyükelçim.
Teşekkürler. Burada bizim Pakistan Büyükelçimiz kardeşimiz var. İngilizce söylüyorum. Let me use in English in honor to our brothers, colleagues. First of all, again, thank you very much. And this kind of event, this kind of meetings, very important. And, I hope, and I will be very shortly in this, hope to next our meeting will be offline, not in online. So this way I am wishing you all the best. And the first is, of course, strong health. And, yeah, this kind of meetings very useful also because we learn and how is our, especially in energy potential in each our countries, and let's combine our some possible more efforts and to implement this kind of projects. Thank you again. Teşekkürler hocam.
Biz teşekkür ederiz. Selamlar. Aleykümselam. And let's continue with the Pakistan's ambassador, Muhammad Seyruz Sejat Gazi.
Thank you very much. I would just like to say that it was a very enlightening session. We learned a lot of things about our neighborhood. It was an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much, Mr. Ozan, who's on giving us the opportunity, giving me the opportunity to reconnect with Jamaluddin Bey after some time. He's a great friend of the Pakistan Embassy. He's a great friend of Pakistan. And I know that he and Ambassador Gilani are great friends in Uzbekistan too. Also. For Pakistan, in terms of energy, I would just like to say that it's one of the main priorities of our government. We look forward to all proposals, all ideas, and all comers for viable cooperation in this field, exploration, renewable energy, hydropower. There are already a number of Turkish companies working in Pakistan in the energy sector, and we hope to receive more. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thanks very much. We really thank that. Please, dear Ambassador, it's your turn.
Sayın Büyükelçiler Cemalettin Bey, tekrar çok çok teşekkür ederim. Tekrar çok istifade ettim. It was a great pleasure for me to be part of this very, very important discussion. Afghans are Turk by heart and by DNA. So I come from Ghazni province. It is the birthplace of Sultan Mahmud, where he established a very, very important empire. So I'm proud to be part of this community, very, very important community and union. Afghanistan want to be the connector between all our brothers, especially as it relates to energy. So I hope to be able to continue our collaboration and these very important and useful events. And I'm looking forward to meet up each and every one of you, including and especially Esbam and our brother Sanbe, soon to discuss more. Turkey has enormous potential in terms of soft as well as hard in energy sector, and you'd like to benefit from that, not only as in Afghanistan, but the whole region. So thank you very much again.
Thanks very much. I think we have completed our session. I would like to thank very much to all our speakers, our ambassadors, and also Mr. Jamaleddin Tuney and Elman Nasirov for his participation. And also, again, tell my regards to Mr. Hulusi Kılıç and also our Abdullah Çalışkan, who couldn't attend due to COVID reason. Inshallah, Allah Şafi. Thanks very much. We have to increase our integration. We have to come together much more. And inshallah, in the next year's Congress, we will put more coherent steps to increase the commercial integrity issues together. I'm finishing the session. Thanks very much. Hope to see you again. Regards.
Thank you.